morning. Welcome everyone to our service of worship today and this beautiful summer morning. And a welcome to everyone and a welcome to any visitors here today. I believe we do have some visitors from Spain and Turkey. So a very warm welcome, especially to you if you are here from a further place and come to join with us in the family of God this morning. Just to explain before I lead us into the service of worship, as you'll know, the Scottish Government has made some changes in what we can do as a church. Some of those we've implemented with the choir assisting in the singing from the chancel area. You may have heard about the 1 meter distancing. What we've decided, the session clerks and I, is not to make any changes in that regard until August, because early August, the First Minister will make further pronouncements, and we'll see what is pronounced then, because that would be the only change at the moment, would be the 1 meter distancing. So we thought with the summer attendance we're coping, as it is just now, and then we'll review that in early August. So just to let you know that. The good news I've got to share, of course, is Aberdeen football team 5, Bracken 1. So I know Mr. Leeper will be very happy there at the front of the sanctuary. And long may it continue. Anyway, exciting times at the start of a new competitive season for the Aberdeen football team. And of course, the Olympics are on, and there are so many sports over this summer period. We gather this morning to worship God, to seek His presence among us, and to seek the fellowship and friendship of God's people together, and to be guided in our coming week through His grace, through His Spirit. So let us hear these words in our call to worship, and you're invited to join in the words in bold print. Rejoice, folks, Jesus is in our midst.
Feed us, Jesus, and fill us with hope.
Well, maybe start that again. There should be a sense of anticipation there. Feed us, Jesus, and fill us with hope. I know we can't force things, but it would just think, maybe help us to think what we're reading. Rejoice, folks, Jesus is in our midst.
Feed us, Jesus, and fill us with hope.
Be glad, friends, Jesus has bread and fish to spare.
Feed us, Jesus, from the pursuit of food that does not satisfy.
Sing for joy, people of God. God gathers up the pieces of our lives that nothing may be lost.
Thanks be to God.
And you're invited, if you wish, to stand and sing, as you are comfortable, 601, Look Upon Us, Blessed Lord.
Thank you.
God is near to all who call on him. He listens when we pray. So let us bring our prayers to God with confidence, knowing that he will hear and answer. Let us pray. Lord of all life, beginning and end, provider of food and drink, clothing and warmth, love and hope, life in all its fullness, we praise you. You are the one who sustains us, the one who nourishes and strengthens us throughout our daily lives. When the journey is long and we hunger and thirst, bread of life, you sustain us. When the road is hard and our bodies weak, bread of life, you heal us. When our spirits are low and we can't carry on, bread of life, you revive us. When we offer our hand in love and in service, bread of life, you bless us. When the challenge is great and the workers are few, bread of life, you empower us. When the victory is won and we see your face, bread of life, you will rejoice with us. We praise you. Lord God, you give generously, abundantly your love upon us, like a parent providing for their family's needs. Forgive us, Lord, when, like spoiled children, we treat your generosity as our right or hug onto it possessively. Forgive us that we have kept what we have to ourselves rather than offering it up to you that you might feed and sustain others. Forgive us that we have failed to be concerned about the waste that our society produces. Forgive us when we have wanted more for ourselves at the cost of another. We are sorry, Lord, and in need of your renewing grace. As we gather now to worship you, fill us with anticipation of your work to us. Strengthen us for service. Feed and renew us that we might share in your purpose in giving life to the world. And as now, as part of God's family across the world, we join in the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'm going to be giving a few short readings today, both from the Old Testament and the New Testament, which all relate to the theme of choices. And we'll see that some good choices are made and some bad ones are made. And I'm sure we have experience doing that, both of those ourselves. But our first reading is from the second book of Samuel, chapter 11. From verse 2, and I'm just telling part of the story. It's quite a long and a detailed story in the actual account in the second book of Samuel. But 2 Samuel chapter 11 from verse 2. One evening, David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman washing. The woman was very beautiful, and David sent someone to find out about her. The man said, "She is Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, and the wife of Uriah the Hittite." And David sent messengers to get her. She came to him, and he slept with her. Now she was purifying herself from her monthly uncleanness. Then she went back home. The woman conceived and sent word to David, saying, I am with child. And then the second book of Kings from chapter 4, from verse 42. A man came from Baal Shalishah, bringing the man of God 20 loaves of barley bread, baked from the first ripe corn, along with some ears of new corn. Give it to the people to eat, Elisha said. How can I set this before 100 men? His servant asked. But Elisha answered, give it to the people to eat, for this is what the Lord says. They will eat and have some left over. Then he set it before them, and they ate and had some left over according to the word of the Lord. And in the New Testament, we read from the Gospel according to John, in chapter 6, from verse 8. And the context of this is that it's the feeding of the 5,000, but I'm just reading a particular part of that story. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish, but how far will they go among so many? Jesus said, make the people sit down. There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted. So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. Amen, and may God bless to us the reading and hearing of his word. We sing our next hymn, which is 634 in the hymn book, Word of the Father.
Thank you.
Now the last of our lectionary readings for today is from the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 3. Sometimes a passage that I would use at weddings, although the love that it's referring to is broader than the love shared between husband and wife. But let's hear what God's word says in Ephesians chapter 3 from verse 14. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. There's just a thought went through my mind as I read that, and it relates to what I'm going to say in the sermon. Grasp is used there in that passage, but what we are to grasp is the love of God. To grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. Obviously, what we saw with David was he grasped another man's wife. But here there is the sense that we are to search, seek after, long for the love of God, which then pushes us out to one another and beyond. And now may the words of my lips, the meditation of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and redeemer. Amen. The Bible reflects the complexity of human nature, its heights, its depths, the great strengths, the great abilities and gifts of human beings, but also the great tragedy of how those abilities are often misused and abused. The contradictions of, on the one hand, faithfulness to God, and then abandonment, running away from God. The contrast between giving, sharing, wholehearted dedication and commitment, to the opposite, greed and grabbing and godlessness. These are all reflected in the scriptures. And great art reflects the complexity of human nature, the contradictions, the opposites expressed, and profoundly the spiritual moral struggles that go on within each one of us. In King David, we observe a man of contradictions, a man who God anointed to be king, a young man of faith, the composer, the author of the Psalms, also a strong military leader who trusted in God and achieved great victories. But yet, very clearly, in the Old Testament record, he is a man who could make wrong choices, who broke three of the Ten Commandments. He coveted his neighbor's wife. He commits adultery. He plans the murder of her husband, Uriah, so that he will not be found out. David's choices bring death, death of the innocent Uriah. And yet God can work through these wrong choices. David and Bathsheba were the parents of Solomon, who was to be the next king of Israel. And we know about the wisdom of Solomon, although many people comment, was he wise to have so many wives? But anyway. 2 Kings 4 speaks about the feeding of 100 people with 20 loaves. When it says loaves, it's more like a roll, it's not a great big loaf. And the servant who comes to Elisha with that, you know, thinks, how can these 100 men be fed with these 20 loaves? And Elisha encourages him, exhorts him to trust in God, and how much this prefigures, of course, what we hear in the Gospel of John, when Andrew and Philip come across this boy with his 5 loaves and 2 fishes. But how can this feed these crowds here? The above passages teach us about the different aspects of need and God's response to our very longings. In the book of Samuel, in the account of King David, the most basic physical desires, both for sexual pleasure and control, are there. In the book of Kings, there is a foretaste of the feeding of the 5,000. The need for physical nourishment is blessed in amazing ways by God. And in the letter to the Ephesians, we learn of the spiritual need within us all to be filled with God's saving grace. The amazing thing is, when we read these passages, is that at first might seem to not easily go together. A theme that is running through each of them, even in David's one, is that God is at work in each situation, reproaching, as he does through the prophet Nathan to David, redeeming, nurturing, filling and blessing our lives. And so I want us to reflect just a wee bit more on these accounts that we have. Let's look at the distinction, the difference between two men in the account of the second book of Samuel. You have King David, who in some ways has a good spiritual heritage. He's got good marks for his faith and his actions up to this point. But now he feels powerful and invincible. He is at home at the palace while others who are under his orders, his command, are fighting a battle, and his mind or his eyes drift and he looks ahead or over to Bathsheba and he starts to plan, to plot. And what this expresses is someone who abuses that position of power that God had led him into. And he is manipulative and controlling, seeing that Uriah will be sent to a battle where he will most surely be killed. And I couldn't help thinking, for all we extol King David in the Christian faith and also in the Jewish faith, this account is not that different from what we hear of the film director-producer Harvey Weinstein. Okay, as far as we know, it's one incident with Bathsheba, but it bears similar characteristics in that it's two men of wealth, of power, of influence, who can get people to follow their orders, and then they can grasp and grab, and they can get off with what they have done, at least in the eyes of the world, it seems. And so how would David do in this sort of Me Too campaign? His abuse of the wife Bathsheba. Uriah, in contrast, Uriah the Hittite is obedient to God. He is carries out a sense of duty, a sense of responsibility, and a dedication and commitment to the nation of Israel. He exercises self-denial. David, to try and make it look like Uriah is the father, encourages Uriah to sleep with his wife, but Uriah will not, because as a soldier, he will wait till the task is completed that he is engaged in. Imagine these two characters in a present-day media situation and the reports. Surely it would have been the end of David. And I'm certainly not justifying or excusing David's actions, but what we do find in this account is that God certainly does not approve of what David has done. That's spoken very clearly of through Nathan the prophet. Yet, even in spite of it, God works through it and brings into the world Solomon, who is to be David's successor. When we go on to the second book of Kings and the other readings we have, these are, let's say, more positive choices. They are more life-fulfilling, life-enriching. Why? Because they are given out to others. They are not just absorbed in what do I get out of it. The short passage that I read from the second book of Kings and the giving of the loaves to Elisha follows on from other parts of where we hear about Elijah and Elisha, where just as the contents of the jar of oil multiply for the widow of Zarephath, as the Shunammite woman is filled with a child, as food is purified so that people are able to eat, so this passage in the second book of Kings is about fulfilling need and as a result, fulfilling God's purpose. The story occurs during a famine when food is not so much a luxury as a necessity. Elisha receives God's promise that there will be plenty, and so it proves. And this passage demonstrates God's miraculous provision for God's people, even in the face of disbelief. Elijah's servant has a genuine and practical question. How will these 12 rolls or 12 loaves feed these 100 men? Elisha replies, saying that thus says the Lord, God has told us to do this, and we do it. It's not for us to reason or why, question everything. What we are to do is be faithful to what God is calling us to do. They embody God's promise that they will eat and there will be some left over. So not only does God meet a necessity, God more than satisfies. And then when we go to John chapter 6, it's very similar in some ways, that experience. It's kind of echoed in the place of Galilee. Maybe what's additional in John's gospel is the setting of it and the echoes of the Exodus story. There is the sense that the big crowd who are gathered are to be the new Israel, and that sometimes has been recognized by the 12 baskets where the bread is left over from after they are fed. That is this the new Israel being fed as the word manna in the desert and now being fed by the bread of life who ultimately is Jesus himself. And so again there is this sense of a need, people gathering around Jesus in their need, and a boy trusting what he has, however little it is, and Jesus blessing it, and it brings fulfillment and brings satisfaction, and even more than could realistically be expected. So how does this all relate to the letter to the Ephesians? Well, in the letter to the Ephesians, we see another need, which in some ways connects with all those needs. Whether it was the physical, sexual need of David, or whether it's the intestinal, it's hard to know if I'm using the right medical term, but need of hunger and food that we have in 2 Kings and in the Gospel of John, there is also that deep spiritual need, which the writer to the Ephesians says can only be met in Christ, through Christ, and through the love of God. And it is through the absorbing ourselves, the grasping of the love of God, recognizing its height, its depth, and so on, that we can be nourished in a way that we can respond appropriately physically to whether it's a hunger or sexual desire or whatever else is part of our human makeup. As we, in a sense, swim in that love of God, we can be more the people that God wants us to be, and we can have more the attitude to the things around us that is right, that is good, that is healthy, and that is a blessing not just to ourselves, but is a blessing to others. Through the COVID-19 pandemic, have we learned anything? We're probably still working that out for ourselves personally. Have we learned anything as a church? What are the things we might focus on now to build up God's church, to feed and to nourish God's people? What are the distractions that have perhaps diverted people away from the church? And how might we gently encourage them back? But in closing, I want to mention that each of the passages that we have read today are to do with choosing. In Samuel, David chooses human lust over divine love, and the consequences are death. Yet God delivers with forgiveness and the birth of another great king. In Kings, the book of Kings, and in the Gospel, the choice is between trust and disbelief, and God delivers with physical nourishment. In Ephesians, the choice is to go beyond simple love of one another and to be completely ruled by Christ's love within us. And God delivers through his amazing grace. In each of these cases, God delivers in the midst of our humanity. May we seek after what will be a blessing to us and a blessing to others, and may God give us the strength to resist the choices that would bring harm to ourselves and to others. In God's amazing love, may we live. Amen. The choir are now going to sing the anthem, Ubi Caritas. Let us pray. God of miracle, provider of daily bread, word of life and love, we thank you for the gift of your Son Jesus, the living bread, broken and shared for all. We thank you that even the crumbs of our lives and of our labours are useful to you in the service of your kingdom. We thank you for your endless, overflowing grace that knows no bounds, even as we seek to limit it through our bad choices. Lord God, as you heard the cries of your people in the wilderness and fed them bread from heaven, as we remember how Jesus nourished your people with words of justice and compassion, hear us today as we pray for our world. We pray for those whose daily need for food, clean water, and proper shelter goes unmet, and for those misusing what they have in the vain pursuit of pleasure. Lord, feed them with a sense of justice and fairness that they might stand firm in their right to a decent life for all people now. We pray for those whose lives have been broken by violence and crime, conflict and struggle. Feed them with courage and anticipation of a life beyond the barriers which hold them back. We pray for those who are sick or sorrowing, and those who care for and console them. We pray especially for those we know personally who are facing difficulties at this time, and who we name in a time of silence. Fill them, Lord, with your healing presence and remind them of your promises. We pray for those who have lost faith in themselves and in you, and who struggle to find meaning in life. Focus their eyes on you, Lord, and give them hope for a new day. We pray for ourselves that we might be filled with energy to serve you better in our daily living, and that we might, even in our doubt, be reminded that you will never turn away or abandon us. May we always look to you as the one who gives us life. Loving Heavenly Father, we give thanks for the great cloud of witnesses who surround us. May we be encouraged and strengthened by their example. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is 622 in the hymn book, and it is We Sing a Lark.
Thank you.
nourished in the love of God, to be generous in the way of Christ Jesus, and to be filled and fueled by the Spirit of the breath of God. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, descend upon you, dwell within you, this day and evermore.
Thank you.